I've entitled this message, Freedom from the Mark of the Beast. And I'm going to talk about the Mark of the Beast. I don't know that I'll get there today. Honestly, I don't know. We will get there. You know, all right? So I want to talk about it in maybe a little bit different light than many of you have heard it. I want to talk about it in what I call the now revelation. There's a past. He was, and he is to come. Amen? And so, but before we get there, I want to just say, you know, I say this all the time. Ignorance is not your friend. Ignorance is your enemy. And I've said many times it's not foolish to be ignorant, but it is foolish to remain ignorant. And how vital it is that we allow the Lord to teach us. You know, one of the things I noticed about this past Thursday, and I've been noticing it, there's just such a sweet spirit of calm. And you know, even like when we're done, everybody just sits there. That's a good thing. I'm thinking, well, I'm going home. You guys have a nice day. Love you. But you know, that's a good thing. But I mean, there's just such a peace in his presence. And you know, his presence is ever abiding. It's always with us. He never leaves us nor forsakes us. But you know, sometimes we're more sensitive to that. In other words, it's up to us how much we want. It's not up to God. God's done everything. But it's up to me to respond to that. It's up to me to be intimate with him. And we'll talk about some of those things. I want to do just a couple things. One of them I did Thursday. The other one I did not do Thursday. But I just want to give you a couple examples of ignorance. Are you ready? This one I did Thursday, and it deals like Proverbs 29:18. Many of you know this verse, and it says, "Where there's no vision, the people perish." Right? And we all—that's the first part of it. I just want to give you the first part of it for now. And people will say all the time, "Well, if you don't have a vision, then you're just falling away." You know, you need to have a vision. And so people are out there trying to get a vision. You know, you don't have to try to get a vision. Amen. It's all him. See, the enemy don't care what you look at as long as it isn't Jesus Christ and his finished work. He doesn't care. I was even telling my wife, I go, even worship. Like, I believe in worship, man. Worship's powerful. But you know, it's not about worship. It's about Jesus. Amen. Worship is how we look at Jesus and we glorify him and we praise him and we worship him and all that stuff. But see, sometimes we get into the mechanics of all these things and we're really very subtly looking away from Christ. But see, it says, where there's no vision, the people perish, but happy is he that keeps the law. It actually says, if you look at many translations, without a revelation, the Amplified Bible says something to that effect. People will cast off restraint. Give me the Amplified, please. Where there's no vision, no redemptive revelation of God, the people perish. Isn't that powerful? So if you're not seeing what Jesus did, like people say, well, unless you be born again, you won't go to heaven. That's true. I'm not minimizing that, but that's not what it says. He said, unless you're born again, John 3:3, you can't even see the kingdom of God. You can't even see it. I'm looking at the kingdom of God right now. Hello, kingdom. Amen. It's his reign. Hallelujah. See, ignorance is not our friend, but a lot of times we have these mindsets that keep us from seeing all that Christ did. See, without any vision or clear vision of the redemptive revelation of God, which is Jesus, the people perish. But he who keeps the law of God, and we're not under the Mosaic law, but we're not lawless. We have the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, Romans 8:2, the perfect law of liberty, James 1:25. That's what's in us. He wrote that. That's where I went to school. He writ that in our hearts, right? Amen? Hallelujah. So anyhow, I just wanted to throw that one at you. Let me give you another one that I think is powerful. I heard someone recently say stuff like, now this sounds really good. Well, we just teach people how to be like Jesus. Doesn't that sound good? On the surface, doesn't it? On the surface, hey, should be like Jesus, man. WWJD, what would Jesus do? You know that's very wrong. You know that's not New Covenant. Some of you are looking at me like a cow at a new gate, but it is not New Covenant. If you're born again, you're already like Jesus. Amen. The only thing that keeps you from acting, I hate that word, living like that is you just don't know it. If you're born again, now some people aren't born again, I will grant you that. Tares among the wheat, all that stuff. But if you're born again, you are like Jesus. As he is, you all know that part of 1 John 4:17, so are you in this world right now. Let me liken it to you this way. Can you imagine someone coming up and saying, hey, you just need to be like Chris. You just need to be like Chris, or I'm already like me. right? See, people don't understand what Christ did. It's a oneness thing. You don't, the beauty of it. I said this one Wednesday night. I heard a man say something like, well, if you're not disciplined enough to fast, then that food's got power over you. And I'm all for discipline. But listen, all of a sudden I started thinking about it, and it became a battle between me and that hamburger. I thought, where's Jesus? You know, I don't got to whip the hamburger. He already whipped it. Glory to God. Amen. See, it's total freedom. But it's not freedom to sin, it's freedom from sin. We're going to see that now. John chapter 8, verse 30. We'll do a few verses here. John chapter 8, verse 30. Some of you know this. And he spake these words, and as he spake, Jesus spake these words, many believed on him. Next verse. Then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him. Now this is powerful. I sit there and think about things. And let me say this to you. I have discovered and continue to discover that if you don't tell people the truth, and you think, well, I'm just not gonna say the truth. I'm gonna be politically correct. Eventually, what's in them comes out anyhow. You know what I'm saying? In other words, being politically correct isn't the answer. Speaking the truth in love, it says in Ephesians, that is the answer. Jesus is the truth. You speak it in love. Amen. Now, then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him, if you continue in my word, the word continues, the Greek word meno. Meno. Not minnow, meno. Means abide. Okay? In my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. In your next verse, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Now, let me just stop here for a minute. You've heard this before. But he says, if you abide, if you continue in my word, then you're my disciple. The word disciple means learner. And then you're going to know the truth. Jesus is the truth. The truth is a person. Sanctify them through thy word. Thy word is truth. John 17, 17. That means set them apart. You know what holiness means? See, we think holiness is, aww. You remember the second Ace Ventura? Alrighty now. You know what holiness actually is? It's separation. Did you know that? When the world's depressed, you're happy. When the world's sick, you're healthy. That's what holiness is. It means separation. You're separated unto God. You're separated from the corruption in this world. That's what holiness is. Hallelujah. But it says you'll know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. It's going to make you free when you know the truth. In other words, it's an automatic byproduct of knowing the truth. I like to say it like this, and we talked about this a little bit Thursday night. I can tell who you've been intimate with. As the bride of Christ, we can tell who you've been intimate with by how the children look. Now, I know there's exceptions. Listen, if you're intimate with him, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faithfulness, meekness, and temperance or self-control. Against such there is no law. In other words, if you're having a relationship with the Lord, that's the byproducts of your life. Hallelujah. Glory to God. But see, the more you know, the more you draw close to him. The more, listen, if you let him love you, I'm married to my wife, but if I never communicate with her or have any relationship with her, it's not going to be a very good marriage. And there's a lot of Christians that like, they just think, well, I don't know. Let go. He loves you. He wants to lavish his love and his blessing all over you. All the time. Amen. You know, I heard Pastor Paul White, not Paula, please don't go there. Nothing against her. She just needs the new covenant. But Pastor Paul White said something. He goes, I can't preach anymore and not smile. Yeah. I'm struggling too. Why? Because it's good news. There's no more, it's no more yoke of bondage. It's no more not measuring up. It's no, I've said Thursday night, you can't mess it up. You can mess your life up and go to jail, but you can't mess up the new covenant. Amen. You can't out-sin his grace. Some are thinking, well, take that as a challenge. Hallelujah. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. I want to say this. Here again, I read this Thursday. I got to read it again. E.W. Kenyon. Now, I say that because there's a lot of intellectual meatheads out there that like to criticize it. I'm saying that for the benefit of the recording, all right? Powerful man of God. I recommend his writings. Okay? Hallelujah! unfairly criticized by a lot of people. But that's neither here nor there. I'm not trying to I'm trying to defend against the false accusations because it keeps you away from a lot of the revelation that he had. But he said this. He fell away. I'm reading his autobiography. He fell away for like 3 years. And he gave one of the reasons he fell away was because he didn't understand the new covenant. Amen. And listen to what he said. I want to read this to you. Great enthusiasm and joy come at the new birth, Kenyon wrote. But unless that is cared for and fed by the mind being renewed through feeding on the word and practicing it, the joy will die out. And see, I see that a lot. If you're intimate with him. Listen, my wife and I will never have a divorce as long as we continue to be intimate one with another. I'm not talking about just in the bedroom either. I'm talking about taking walks and communicating. Let me tell you, the primary basis of intimacy is communication. Amen? But see, and God will never forsake his end of it, but I'm saying that you can walk away and not experience all the joy and the blessing of being married to him if you just don't allow him to love you. That's what intimacy is. We make okay, Chris, how many hours do I have to pray a day? Oh, stop that nonsense. You don't have to pray at all. I now pronounce you man and wife. You may kiss your bride. Do I have to? You get to. It's a privilege. It's an honor to relate to him. Amen? Back up to John chapter 8, verse 32. Watch this. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. 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 Powerful. Free. Next verse. Then answered him, we be Abraham's seed. And we were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, you shall be made free? Now stop. I want to relate this to you and I. Let me tell you one of the big keys in biblical interpretation. This will bless your socks off if you hear it. Is realizing the immediate context, the historical context of who he was talking to will help you apply it to your life today. Okay? He's talking to these Jews. We see that. And he said, man, we're Abraham's seed. And I thought, well, I grew up religiously. I'm born again. I go to this church. I do this. I do that. I've read the Bible. I've heard a ton of messages. And that's our problem. Amen or oh me, right? That's a lot of our problem. You see, sometimes what has happened, I know what happened to me, is I had to unlearn a lot of stuff. Amen? And that's where a lot of us are at today. We're having to unlearn. Do you know there's places that I want to go that we can't go? You know why? Because people hear it as a law. Are you hearing me? People hear things as a law and they don't realize how loved and accepted they are. They can't mess it up. I'm going to say that again. You can't mess it up. The only way you can mess it up is if Jesus can mess it up. You know you can never come under a curse. The only way you can come under a curse is to believe you can come under a curse. Or if Jesus can come under a curse, then he can't. Amen. I'm just going to give you this quick. Are you ready? In James chapter 3, you know the tongue, verb chapter? Let's go there. might be not as quick as I thought. But James chapter 3, verse 1. Watch this. My brethren, be not many masters. Now the word there, masters, in the old King James means teachers. Everybody say teachers. Teachers. Knowing that we shall receive a greater condemnation or a more stricter judgment, teachers, on account of what they say. Now, next verse, watch this. For in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, what word is he talking about? We always apply it individually. He's talking about the word from the pulpit or the word that's being taught. That's what he's leaving in context. If any man offend not in word, he is a perfect or complete man. He's able also to bridle the whole body. Do you know people are bridled in the body of Christ by what's taught from pulpits? Yeah. I love what Joseph Prince says. The pulpit should pull you out of the pit, not into the pit. Amen. Amen. And so many times it's pulling people into the pit. But that's why he says teachers have the ability to bridle the body of Christ and lead them out or in. It's like putting a bit in a horse's mouth. You know, I've been around people, and I know who they're listening to by how they act. I'll never forget. I worked with one guy And I knew the church he went to, very legalistic and self-righteous. Hey, I've been there. I got a few t-shirts, self-righteousness. And I remember people saying, "You got to live right, don't you? Johnny," not his real name. And he was like, "That's how it makes you, for benefit of the seated. You're like this, judgmental." I mean, I was judgmental. I remember being in the parking lot in Sydney, Ohio, of the pub, and thinking, heathens. I used to go there. I remember when I first got saved, I'd put tracks in the restroom. I'd be in the pub. Well, you know, you start, what do you think? You come into the body of Christ, you think you got to do to be accepted. And the whole thing is, no, he did it all. And that's what people choke on. Every bit of it is done. Woo! Yeah. Glory to God. So many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word of doctrine, a word of teaching, the same as a perfect man, he's able also to bridle the whole body. Next verse. Behold, we put bits in the horse's mouth that they may obey us. We turn about their whole body. Next verse. Behold also the ships which show they are so great and are driven of fierce winds. Winds of doctrine. I'm moving right along. Yet they are turned about with a very small helm whithersoever the governor listeth. Next verse. Even so the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold how great a matter a little fire kindleth. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. We're talking about the tongue of a teacher. So is the tongue among our members, the body of Christ. It defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature. And it is set on fire of hell. You know, if the enemy can get the pulpit. If he, see, I'm telling you. I said it last week, and I never thought I'd say stuff. Sometimes I think I'm not going to say that, and then I say it anyhow. But you know, if the government said, you know, no Christian TV, it might not be a bad thing. Get some of these yahoos off there. I'm not judging their heart, but I'm judging the yahoo teaching their teaching. Because it's binding you. If you're basing it on anything but Jesus Christ and Him crucified, all that Christ did, you're a mess. You are. Because you, it don't take a lot either. Just a little leaven. Just a little bit. Keep going on. I'm going to finish this. For every kind of beast and of birds and of serpents and of things in the sea is tamed and hath been tamed to mankind. Next verse. But the tongue can no man tame and is unruly, evil, full of deadly poison. Next verse. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude or similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. Next verse. Doth the fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Can a fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries, either a vine fig, so can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh? Okay. Now let me say this to you. When it says, therewith bless we God and curse men, it's not saying we get up and say, you blankety blank blanks. I was getting a kick out of that. Anyhow, but moving right along, it's actually the word that's used for cursing the law. Therewith bless we men by telling them who they are in Christ, and in the next breath, we curse them by telling them it's based on their performance instead of what Jesus did. That's what that's saying. Hallelujah. Leave it in context. And that's why it's so dangerous. Extremely dangerous. Now, let's go to Romans chapter 6. Because we're going to start talking about identification. As we prepare to talk about freedom or release from the mark of the beast. You are free. Everybody say, I'm free. I'll tell you what. Go to John. Let me finish John chapter 8. I'm going to do a couple more verses and then we'll go to Romans chapter 6. John chapter 8 and verse 32. We'll just go there quickly. I'm just going to, John 8, 32, shall know the truth shall make you free, that whole context there. They're quick back there, not that quick. And you shall know the truth and the truth shall make you free. In other words, it's not the truth that makes you free, it's the truth you know, intimacy, relationship, amen? Then answered him, and we be Abraham's seed, we're never in bondage to any man, how sayest thou, you shall be made free. Next verse, Jesus answered them, verily I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin, watch this, is the servant or the slave of sin. You see that? See, the reason people sin is because they're enslaved to a sin nature. I like to say that if you're not born again, you're a child of the devil. You're in one of two kingdoms, God's kingdom or the enemy's kingdom. That's why Colossians 1:13 says you've been translated out of the kingdom of darkness and into the kingdom of his dear son. I got talking to a brother at Kroger's the other day, a brother in Christ, and we were talking about this. He's all messed up about like end time stuff. And I go, it's not what they're saying. I go, the kingdom of God's here right now. It's not coming, it's here. But if you think it's coming, then you may as well hide your bomb shelter and eat your spam because, wait for somebody to push the button. We're here to take over, not hide. It's sensationalism, man. It's selling books. They're selling you poop paddles and everything else that you can, when you're hiding out, man, you can go. I'm saying you can go get a little paddle at Walmart. You don't have to spend money on that. It's the truth. It's garbage. It's, you know what I listen for when I listen? Where's Jesus? Where's Jesus? Is this exalting what Christ did, or is this telling me I need to live in fear? You know, can I tell you this? I was talking to this person. They said, they like this certain preacher, and he's an end time preacher and all that kind of stuff. And I said, I apologize because this goes against the whole Nebuchadnezzar's image. And I just said, it's real simple. The 10 toes of the Roman Empire said, who was in power when Jesus walked the earth? The Romans. But because people are intellectual, there's a lot of intellectual idiots. Did you know that? What were we watching last night? We were watching public broadcasting. And they were talking about, scientifically, dimensions. My wife and I, we were both looking at you. Well, there's three dimensions, the breadth, the length, and the height, or whatever it is. And then this guy was talking to this guy from Harvard. And he was from Harvard. And he was asking him about, he goes, it's like when you walk in and you see a garden hose, it looks like a lion. And then you get closer and you realize it's a garden hose. And I'm thinking, duh. And then when you back away, it goes back to a lion. I'm thinking, how... Just because you can say big words doesn't mean you're smart. I knew one guy, man, he read a dictionary. That's what he did. And so he could go around and say, the answer is most horrific. And I'm thinking, what are you saying? Anyhow, so Jesus said, verily I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin, he's the servant or the slave of sin. Two more verses. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the son abides forever. The son abides forever. I want to say this to you, and it might rock your boat. I am a friend of God. No, you are not.
Thank you, Jesus.
No, you are not. I have friends, but they can't come in my house and eat my food. You are a son of God. Abraham was a friend before Christ came. Jesus said to his disciples before the cross, I don't call you servants, but I call you friends. You're not a friend of God. You're a son of God.
Come on. Amen.
You can have friends, but I guarantee you, I don't care how close they are. I don't have any friends that could come to my house and go eat my Swiss cake rolls. None. I love you, but not that much. John's like, John's hurt. John, you can. Okay. You hide them, right? But see, you're a son. You're a son. I'm not talking about male or female. You're all sons of God, Galatians 3:26. If you're born again, you're a son. You're not a friend of God.
Amen.
Hallelujah. How many things we sing. Now listen, hear me. I got to say this because some people will choke on this. Yes, you have children. They grow up. You hope that there's a friendship there, okay? Just like, I'm not a servant, but I'm a son who serves. Are you hearing that? Yes, we serve. Yes, we have fellowship and intimacy. Intimacy is beyond friendship. Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah. But see, because we don't know the difference and we don't rightly divide the word, just like I told you the one the other week, you can't surrender all. You can't surrender something that doesn't belong to you. You're not God's rental property. I've already surrendered my life to Him. I can't do it again. I can't surrender somebody else's coat to you. It's not mine. You're not your own. You're bought with a price.
Come on. Amen.
Hallelujah. That's liberty. That's freedom. But see, what you don't know is not freedom. Hallelujah. I got lots of time. I'm excited about this. One more. The Son abides forever. You are in Him. You are a son. If therefore the Son shall make you free. How's it go, Sam? You shall be free indeed. You are free in everything. You are free. If the Son shall make you free. Now, this was before the cross. Has the Son made you free? Absolutely. Absolutely. You're free from the yoke of bondage. What is the yoke of bondage? It's the rules and requirements of the old covenant. which no one could measure up to. Hallelujah. You know, I want to say this to you. This is life and death. The Lord showed me the only way that people operate under a curse and operate is because they don't realize that Jesus did it all. Amen? They don't realize it. And that's why people operate. I'm going to say it. I am going to say it. God's called you to never be sick, ever. The only way you can get sick is if Jesus can get sick. Oh, hallelujah. But what if I do, brother? Here again, we need to take care of ourselves. I got to say all these things. But I'm saying, is Christ sick? Answer, no. Then you are as he is, so are you in this world. Hallelujah. Glory to God. That should make you happy, but people get mad about it. If therefore the Son shall make, if the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. Now go to Romans chapter 8. We're going to talk a little bit about identification because this has everything to do with being released from the mark of the beast. Romans chapter 6, verse 1. I got to say, oh, this is so good. Everybody say identification.
Identification.
You know, there's a lot of ID theft going on. Identification theft going on today. You see it all the time. But our bank has a thing out there. Be careful of identity theft. But there's been identity theft going on in the body of Christ for a long time. See, your identity, and I'm going to say this to you. Everything Jesus is, that's who he's made you. When the Father looks at you, he sees total Jesus because you're in him. There's no separation. It's a total oneness. That's powerful. That's powerful. You know why we have fear? You know what fear is? It's believing you deserve judgment. That's what fear is. It's believing I deserve a judgment. Well, you got to say this. Like I say, if I go in and smack a Walmart greeter, there's consequences for that. But there's no judgment from God. None. Because Jesus already took the judgment. There can be no judgment. You know, once you're acquitted of a crime in our society, you cannot be judged for it again. That's the way you need to look at it. Even fear. That's why the Bible says perfect love is his love. Cast out fear. Hallelujah. Romans chapter 6, verse 1. I'm going to say some things. Glory to God. This is so good. I actually brought a bunch of, got the 26 trans out here, and I brought a bunch of different translations. So I'm gonna read it from here. So, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Now, you know why people persist in sin? They don't understand they're dead. I've heard people say, Christian people say that, well, isn't God trying to improve me? No. Not at all. God's not trying to, you know, this walk, I'm not a souped up Chris. Amen? And neither are you a souped up whoever you are. That's why he says you're dead. The Bible says in Colossians chapter 3, let's go there, chapter 3, verse 1, and we'll come back to 6, verse 2. Colossians chapter 3, verse 1. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Next verse. Set your affection and your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. Next verse. For you are dead. You're dead. And your life is hid with Christ in God. Now look at the next verse. Based on what I've just said, when Christ who is our life shall appear, then shall also appear with him in glory. Next verse. This is what I'm after. Mortify, therefore. Do you see that? Based on what a therefore, when you see a therefore, you need to see what it's, you know, therefore. All right? Mortify, therefore. Based on what I said, that you're dead, you've been raised up, seated with him in heavenly places in Christ, it says in Ephesians 2 also. Based on that, you now have the ability to mortify these things. Do you see that? Now back to Romans chapter 6, verse 2. Oh, glory. Before I proceed any further, let me just say this, and I'm going to prove it to you as one interpretation. The mark of the beast, I believe with everything in me, is not something you get. It's something you get rid of. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, I'm sorry. I just seen the E in my brain and it came out Ephesians. But it's actually Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 18. I said in my heart concerning the estate of the sons of men, that God might manifest them, and that they might see that they are beasts. Without the Spirit of Christ, people operate like animals. Sophisticated animals, but animals nonetheless. Amen. Even in the church world. I love you, brother. Hope you break your neck. Right? Come on. The only hope is what Christ has done. Now, let me say this. I'm not coming against any preterist or futurist interpretation. If a computer chip comes, first of all, if I take it, I'm still going to heaven. It says the mark. It doesn't say it's the mark of the man in Greek. It says it's the mark of man. I'm going to go down these things. And we're going to do, you know what we're going to do? I'm not bringing a USA Today in here to compare it with the Bible. I'm just actually going to compare the Bible with the Bible.
Amen.
Imagine that. Imagine that. It'll actually be about Jesus and what he's done. And you'll see as we go down through there that even calling fire down from heaven, doing signs and wonders. Who called fire down from heaven? His name was Elijah. 2 Kings chapter 1. It's called about judgmentalism. See, that's why Revelation says it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. You get to the very end of the book. He says, now the Spirit and the Bride are saying, come. Why? Because he took all your judgment. But see, for so often, the Spirit's been saying, come. But the church has been saying, get your act together, then you can come. Come on. That's good preaching. I don't care who you are. Amen. I'm telling you, I just grieve sometimes at the stuff that's propagated in the name of God. It grieves me. The King isn't coming. He's already come.
Amen.
I'm not saying Jesus isn't physically going to return to the earth. I do believe that. And I do believe this earth belongs to him. But I'm telling you, if you're waiting on some manifestation of God, then you're not occupying till he comes. How about that one? Amen. He's here right now. He's in you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. The fullness of the Godhead dwelt in him bodily, and the fullness of the Godhead dwells in his body.
Hallelujah.
Now operate like it. You know how many times I feel like, well, I don't know if I have enough faith. You have enough faith. He gave you his faith. I hate religion. I despise it. I get mad. That's what I'm trying to calm down. I thought about sitting in a chair here because it calms me down. Even if I don't sit in it. God forbid, how shall we that are dead do sin live any longer therein? Next verse. Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Now here's what I want you to say. He said this. He said, don't you know? What is our problem? Ignorance. Watch this. Are you ignorant that all who were immersed into Christ were immersed into his death? Have you forgotten? Do you not know that all of us have been baptized into union with Christ Jesus, have been baptized into his death? Verse 4, therefore we are buried with him in death. We are buried with him in death. That like as Christ was raised up from the dead, watch this, even so we also should walk in the newness of life. Let me say this, you don't have two natures. There's real popular teaching going around that says, well, you just got a sin nature. You don't have a sin nature. If you're born again, I'm assuming you're born again. If you're not born again, you got one. And you're a child of the devil. So we can change that, though. You can get out of that kingdom into this kingdom, his kingdom. You don't have two natures. Do you know if you have two natures, you're a freak? When you receive this nature, his nature, you lose the old satanic nature. We cannot have two natures at the same time. If you did, you would belong to two families at the same time. God would be your father and Satan would be your father. When you died, you would go both to heaven and hell. That's a wingspan, ain't it? Amen. You don't have two natures. You got one. You're born again. You died. You're buried with Christ. You're raised up with him. And the sooner we realize that, I hear people, there's one prominent ministry that claims to be preaching the cross and they keep telling you got a sin nature. They're not preaching the cross. Amen. They're preaching a counterfeit cross. It's not the cross. I don't care how many good things they have. The Lord told me one time, what is mixture? He said it has good things and bad things. That's why people don't see it. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We're just about done. Hang on. All right. Now, therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised from the dead. Watch this. Even so we also should walk. Everybody say walk. in the newness of life. Now, I wrote a note here for newness. Well, I can tell you what it says. It means a new quality of life. It means, are you ready for this? This is going to rock your world if I can find it, but because there's other ones I want to give you. But if not, I can share it with you. In the newness of life, there it is. Thank you, Jesus. It gives a new quality to life and service. It's the life of a new quality. It says we should walk this way. It says in Romans 7, we serve, same Greek word, newness. Only two places in the New Testament, Romans 7, 6. While the phrase stands for the new life of the quickened spirit of the believer, it is impossible to separate this from the operation of the Holy Spirit, by whose power the service is rendered. Now watch this, newness. He or she that has ears to hear, let him hear. Ready? It means newness of invention in the field of speech. Hello, prayer language. That's killable. Isn't that powerful? Isn't that powerful? You know, one of the reasons Kenyon said he fell away is because he didn't receive the Holy Spirit. You can be growing in the new covenant and have a relationship, fellowship with the Holy Spirit and fall away. It's impossible.
Amen.
It's impossible. See, you know what people fall away from? Religion. And sometimes it's their own doing because they just say, listen, he's real. Go all the way. Burn the bridges. Be intimate. And I can tell by the children in your life who you've been intimate with. Amen? I can tell if you've been in the tent with him and you've had fellowship with him because your children will look like him. They'll act like him. They'll talk like him. It's called the fruit of the Spirit. But Romans chapter 6, let's finish. Let's do verse 4 and then we'll go to verse 5. Know ye not, therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life, of the quality of life. Next verse. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Paul called it the power of his resurrection in Philippians 3:10. Next verse. Knowing this, herein lies the problem. Do you know this? Let me give you some other translations. Knowing this, let us never forget that our old selves died with him on the cross. Let us never forget. But I talk to people that have been saved for years and don't know that. And that's why we walk around condemned. That's why we have fear, because we somehow think we're getting what we deserve. You get what Jesus deserves. He already took what you deserve. But if you don't know, listen, I'll pick on me. I get offended, but I'll be back Thursday night. Don't worry. I see fear in my life at times. I think, oh no. Because I'm looking at myself and I'm thinking, well, I haven't been all that I should be. And I love God. I'm going full tilt as far as I know. I mean, I love him. And see, it's not about being anything. It's about realizing who you are. But see, you know what that tells me? That's a level of ignorance in my life. Whenever there's a level of ignorance, there's room for fear. There's room for all that stuff. Like, God's going to leave you hanging. God's never going to leave you hanging. And you can be so bold. You can go into a situation and know that God's with you. If God's called you to that situation, he's with you. He'll never leave you hanging. Hallelujah. But so often we do our own thing. And the whole time God's trying to tell you, don't marry that one. Marry, you know, he tells you all that stuff. Hallelujah. I get so excited. Where are we at? Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him. When you died? At the cross. When he was crucified, you were crucified. Look at this. That the body of sin might be destroyed. Literally in Greek, it's katergeto. It means unemployed. It means paralyzed. Now we have a body. This isn't my glorified body. I have one. But you know what? This body receives all the benefits of redemption. Is to receive it. That's God's desire. Amen? Boy, it's quiet. No amens. Okay. That the body of sin, the thing that makes us sin, might be katergeto. That it might be unemployed, made idle. That we should not serve sin. Praise God. Next verse. For he that is dead is freed from sin. If you know you're dead, and his death was your death, if you know that, guess what? You'll operate in freedom from sin. But the flip side of that is if I don't know it, I won't operate that way. Next verse. I'm going to burn through some of these. Now, if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. Knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more, death hath no more dominion over him. Next verse. For in that he died unto sin once. Once. But in that he liveth unto God. Next verse. Likewise reckon. Now this is what I used to prove that Paul was a hillbilly. Y'all, and likewise reckon ye also yourselves. That's an accounting term. Yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. See, if you realize this, then when you act contrary to who you are, you think, that ain't even who I am. You just realize it's a freedom. Are you hearing me? It's a freedom. And we'll get into the mark of the beast. Don't fear not. Not today, but we will get there. But alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Next verse. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal bodies, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. I'm trying to get to something here. Keep going. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves. Boy, that's a powerful word. Yield. Just yield. Just yield. Yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. Next verse. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. If you flip that coin around, if you're under the law, sin will have dominion over you. You know the biggest thing I try to implement in Joel? Because he'll start telling me about kids at school and stuff like that. I say, Joel, we don't want to be self-righteous here. We need to pray for them. That's the sickest sin of all, in my opinion, is self-righteousness. You know, look at that. I realize, well, they don't have a home life like you do, or they have this. We need to pray for them. You know, they need to know how much Jesus loves them. Rather than, well, they're doing this. You know, well, I'll tell you what. Thank God I'm not like other men. I pray, I give fast, I give tithes of all that. I'm not even like this old publican over here. The Bible says in John 18, he prayed by himself. You know what I believe? I believe the devil's going to handle that one. I'm out of here. This guy's making me want to vomit. He's about as self-righteous as you can get. He prayed with himself. And the Bible says he despised others. You know the sure sign of self-righteousness? Are you ready? You despise others. That's Luke chapter 18, verse 9 on down. That is the sign of self-righteousness. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you're not under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? God forbid. Certainly not. No way. Now watch this. Know ye not to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey? His servants ye are, to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. Keep that up there. Now you see the words obey and obedience. You know what that's talking about? I always struggled with this word. You know why? Because it was always taught to me, obey. Yes, I'm listening. I don't want to, but I'm listening. That's not what it's saying. You know the word obey is actually hupo, which is a preposition. It means under. And akouo, where we get acoustics. It means hearing under. Are you hearing me? Are you hearing under what I just said? Some of you got to get that. I'm trying. All right. Know ye not to whom ye yield yourselves servants to hear under? His servants ye are to whom you hear under, whether of sin unto death or of hearing under into righteousness. When you hear under the new covenant of what Christ has done, the Bible says in a few verses later, verse 22, you have your fruit unto holiness. Hallelujah. That's what it's talking about. Who are you hearing under? Are you hearing under a new covenant frequency? Are you hearing under an old covenant frequency? I like what Mark said Thursday night. He goes, they walked out. And he said there was a time they walked out of a church. You know why? The guy got up and started teaching on dietary laws. A lot of that goes on Christian TV too. Yep. Just buy my book and it'll tell you not to eat pork. You mess with my bacon, I get upset. If you don't want to eat pork, that's your business. But if you're going to put those in, and I'll say, well, health reasons or whatever. No, it's called putting people back under the law. And what kills people is the law. That's what people are turned off by. They're not turned off by Jesus. He's irresistible. You can't be turned off by Jesus. You can only be turned off by the representation of him, which is inaccurate. Amen. Next verse. But God be thanked, hallelujah, that ye were the servants of sin. Is that past tense? But God, we thank that you were the servants of sin. You were the slaves of sin. But you have heard under, from the heart, that form of doctrine which was delivered you. You were the servants of sin. But now you're knowing the truth. And the truth is making you free. You can't help it. But thank God be thanked. Amen. Say thank the Lord.
Thank you.
That you were, past tense, you're not a servant of sin. You're not a sinner saved by grace. You're not an old wretch. Hallelujah. You're a new creature changed by grace. That's why he said, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature, a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, look, all things have become new.
Amen.
And if people tell you, boy, you've just given this offering and you will be blessed. Hogwash, it's old covenant. Run like a scalded dog. You're already blessed.
Come on. Amen.
What if the offerings go down? They won't. If people find out who they are, they'll go up.
Come on.
But you got to keep preaching it and preaching it. You can't mix swallowing just to motivate people. If the love of Christ will constrain you, 2 Corinthians 5:14, it will compel you. See, if you're not excited about God, you haven't been fellowshipping with Him. You've been fellowshipping with the law. You've been fellowshipping with something that's cold and dead and it's not alive. Glory to God. Glory to God. Well, I'll tell you what, there's a blessing on this ministry. If you just sow in this ministry, God's going to bless you. No, there's a blessing in Jesus. And you're already blessed because of what He did. Amen. Hallelujah. Demonically inspired stuff that's killing the body of Christ. Blessing God and then cursing people by putting them under the curse of the law. Same Greek word. Same thing, you've been redeemed from the curse of the law. How do I bless God and then put you back under a curse? You're cursed with it. Man, I heard that for a couple times a month. If you hear that one time, get out of that church. You don't even have to pray about it. Don't even have to pray about it. Isn't that powerful? Let's turn over to Malachi chapter 3. Where have you robbed God? In tithes and offerings. Ha! I can't do it as good as Lynn. I tried. Okay. I grew up Catholic. They never did that at the Catholic Church. They just did, all right. So I'm better at that. I'm telling you, if they're saying that what they're doing is they're denying what Jesus has done, that's the spirit of Antichrist. The Bible says in 2 John verse 7, for many deceivers are going out into the world who confess not that Jesus is the Christ. This is a deceiver. The Greek says this is the deceiver and this is the Antichrist. It's the spirit that's pro-God but Antichrist.
Yeah.
And so they're telling you that the work's not finished, so somehow you got to do it to finish the work. That's Antichrist. You know, the one thing I love is I don't care what people think anymore. The truth means more to me than that. I love what I heard Heil say one time. He said, people said, look, if you would just tone down a little bit. And then I think, man, I'm finally starting to do something. And then the Lord will show me something else. And I think, oh, man. But he said, I realize, you know, I'm not God's prostitute. He said, I've told him, and you're not my pimp. I'm not selling out. He's more important. And truth is more important because this will set you free. This will set you free. You know, or people talk. People talk all the time. Let them talk. Hallelujah. Where am I at? But God, we thank that you were the servants of God, but you have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which was delivered you. You've heard under it. Next verse. Being then made free from sin, you became the servants of righteousness. You know what that means? You're a slave of righteousness. You can't help yourself. Somebody stop me. I can't help myself. I just want to do good deeds. I just want to do right things. I love to give. I love to bless people. I just can't help it because that's who I am. But you know, as long as you're under the law, you'll never operate this way. Never. As long as you're under just a little leaven of mixture. It's like those brownies. Man, I made you some wonderful brownies. Curtis, you'll love these brownies. They're really good. Let me show you all the ingredients I put in. Just a little bit of dog poop in there. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. I mean, they're really good, though. It's like, I don't think so. Ooh, that's gross. Okay, can all go to lunch? being then made free from sin, you became the servants of righteousness. I want to finish this chapter quickly. I speak after the manner of the men because of the infirmity of your flesh. For as you have yielded your members servants to uncleanness and to iniquity, even so now yield your members servants to your righteous new nature, unto or into holiness. Next verse. For when you were the servants of sin, you were free from righteousness. In other words, even when you were a servant of sin, you could still do right things. So the flip side of that is, even as a servant of righteousness, doesn't mean you still don't have a bad apple on your tree once in a while. Just because you act like a monkey doesn't mean you are one. I'm convinced that the reason people act like monkeys is because we keep telling them they are. Next verse. What fruit had ye in those things whereof ye are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. But now being made free, not some glad morning, right now, from sin, you become the servants to God. You have your fruit unto holiness. The end, the goal, the outcome is everlasting life. Next verse. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift, everybody say gift?
Yeah.
Of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And eternal life is not some glad morning. Jesus said in John 17:3, this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. Eternal life is now. It's Jesus. He is eternal life. He is the way, the truth, the life. No man comes to the Father but through him. You know that if you're in him, you can come directly to the Father. That's why now you can cry, Abba, Father, Daddy, God. You're not a friend of God. You are a son. You are a son. You're in the family. You can open the fridge. I heard one guy say, he goes, man, my kids, he goes, I travel overseas, and because they're my children, they'll find my stuff, so I hide it. I go in the refrigerator, and I put it back. You ever done that? You go in the refrigerator, and you just, like, set it up real good so no one can see what's behind. You know why? Because as a son or daughter in your household, they can go in and get anything they want. Right? So you hide it. After a while, they get good at figuring out where you hide it. And I marvel at how Gracie can find my dark chocolate stuff. It blows me away. Because I'm thinking I'm hiding it real good. And she's not even 6 yet. She's got an ability to find it. Anyhow. So I'm going to wrap up here today. And so much more good stuff. We're just going to have to stop. And then this is part one of being released from the mark of the beast. Next week, I'm Lord willing, creek don't rise. Or even if it does, I do want to take you down. I want to show you some of those things in the book of Revelation, and I want to give you what I call the now interpretation of it. Okay, so that means I'm not trying to fight when I share these things. I'm just trying to show you Jesus, because it is the revelation of Jesus Christ. It's all we're trying to do. You know, but what I find is a lot of people don't share things because they're afraid of the backlash. Are you hearing me? Because there is a backlash. Sometimes when you share some of these things, then other ministers will say, oh, he just thinks he knows. And they'll do all that stuff. But you know what? I don't care. I really don't. You know why? Because I'm dead.
Amen.
My life is hid with Christ and God. You know, if you're dead, that corpse I told you before, you can kick it. You can spit on it. You can cuss it. You can back talk it. It's a corpse. Now, I'm not saying I operate that way all the time. But I'm saying I'm realizing it more and more. Because I know that the truth that you and I understand of who he is and what he's done, the more free we are. The more free we are, the more free we are to be who we are.
Yes.
And who we are is who he is. Christ in you, the hope of glory. You're his workmanship, Ephesians 2:10. You're his workmanship. You're his workmanship. Created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God has before ordained that you should walk therein. You're his workmanship, created into these good works. It's who you are. You can't help yourself. You're a slave to righteousness. You used to be a slave to sin. Now you're a slave to righteousness. And we're just going to keep telling you as many different angles as we can. Because it's all over the Word. That's why there's only one message. That little book that's open. One message. It's actually in the Greek. It's a booklet. Isn't that powerful? One little booklet. It's not even a book. There's only one message. Jesus Christ and him crucified. Many facets to that one message. The breadth, the length, the depth, and height of his love continues on and on and on and on. And I don't know how to stop, so I'm just going to stop. Amen? If you're not born again, everything starts with being born again. If you're not sure, make sure. Amen? You'll be translated out of the kingdom of darkness and into the kingdom of his dear son. And in fact, I said this, and I want to say it today. The reason the Bible says when you confess him as Lord, you will be saved. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ, it doesn't say if you confess Him as Savior. The church has said that. It says if you confess His Lordship. Why? Because you're breaking the lordship of the adversary, the enemy, Satan. That's why he says, hey, we're Abraham's seed, they said. We've never been in bondage to anyone. And if you go on and read that in John chapter 8, you get down to about verse 38, we went to about verse 36, he starts talking about how, in verse 44, he says, you're of your father, the devil. Isn't that amazing? Ephesians 5:8 doesn't say you were in darkness, it says you were darkness. And that's why Colossians 1:13 says you've got to be translated out of that kingdom and into the kingdom of His dear Son. Romans 10:9 says if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God has raised Him from the dead, we will be saved. Verse 10 says, but for the heart man believes into righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Listen to the linguistic key. I thought this was amazing here. And it says if you confess, it's the Greek word homologiae. Notice, not confessing the Savior, but confessing His Lord. You will be saved. He'll be your Savior. It means to agree, to confess, to proclaim. As a judicial term, the word indicates the binding and public declaration which settles a relationship with legal force. Whoa. Settles a relationship with legal force when you confess His Lordship. Because, see, you break the Lordship of someone else. People say, oh, just come to the altar and confess. A lot of people say a prayer and they never let Him change them. They never let Him come in. Amen. Is this too real? There's a lot of people that have said a prayer and they have, if you don't have any desire for the things of God, that's a good indication you're probably not born again. I'll say that again over here. If you don't have any desire for the things of God, you're probably not born again. You're probably still a child of the devil. I say all that out of love. Make sure you've asked Jesus in your heart. Say, just yield. It's just that simple. Say, just come in. I confess your lordship. Then people say, oh, now I'm not. Satan's not my Lord. I'm my own Lord. You know, it talks about the world's wisdom. It says it's earthly, James chapter 3. It's sensual or sense-led, and it's devilish. You see that? Earthly wisdom that's sense-led is devilish. And it says it's the wisdom of this world. It doesn't say the foolishness of this world. There's a wisdom of this world. Dog eat dog, get all you can get, can all you can get, and sit on the can. Right? It's the world's wisdom. It's the world's wisdom. But God's wisdom says there's something a whole lot bigger than what you can just see with your five senses. Amen? So when you confess Him as Lord, He becomes your Savior. This isn't just when you die. This is in every area. If you're walking around in depression, you need to be saved from that. Amen? If you're walking around with anything contrary to what God says we are, we need deliverance. We need to be saved from that. Are you hearing that? So we settle this. We confess Him as Lord. We believe in our heart that God has raised Him from the dead. Why does He say that? Because we believe in what He did through His death, burial, and resurrection. The natural man says, well, that's why it says the natural man doesn't receive the things of the Spirit. I wasn't there. I didn't see it. But we believe it. And it changes our life. You know what I love being? I love being happy. I got so many things to worry about. You can ask my wife. I said, should we help each other in this area? I mean, honey, I feel fear getting on me. You know, she shaved my head again and I felt this. I think it's a zit on my head. You know, and it started bugging me. And I think, honey, what? I go, honey, it's nothing. And I'm thinking, why is this fear here? It's because I somehow still have this mindset that I deserve a judgment or something. Or I haven't, you know, I'm not identifying with Him as much as I would need to be. Now, that's not a condemnation. That's an encouraging. That's the Lord saying, come up. Come up. Come up into your position. He wants that position to get into my condition. You know what I'm saying? Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Glory to God. We're going to be talking more and more about that. So if you've never made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, if you're not sure, just say it. Just believe it. Say, dear Jesus, come into my heart. I receive You now as my Lord. I believe in my heart that You died for my sins. 3 days later, You rose from the dead. for my deliverance. I believe you were delivered for my offenses and raised for my justification. I confess you, Jesus, as my Lord, and I thank you that you're also my Savior. And everyone said, amen. And once again, if you have any type of ailment in your body, I want someone sitting next to you or yourself, the same power that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you. I want you to lay hands on yourself and speak to that condition and command it by the authority of the name of Jesus to go. Wow. And you don't even have to say gold. Okay? You don't even have to say, you can just say, in the name of Jesus, go. Sometimes it's the simplest things. And we make it so hard. It's not hard. Amen. Glory to God. What's the guy we heard? We think we found another grace preacher. We're so excited about him. Butch, the cowboy preacher. You know what I'm talking about? And remember, if serving Jesus ain't fun, you ain't doing it right. Boy, he had some good things to say that we were excited. So we're going to watch him a little more, and then we'll be recommending him to you. Oh, he's so good.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Come out from among them and be ye separate. Among who? Yeah, I know. There you go, Chris. Turn off those beer commercials. No, leave them on. They're funny. Geico commercials are hilarious. Pure adrenaline. Glory to God. The unbelievers are the people that are causing you to have unbelief in what Jesus did. Say, I'm blessed. I'm super blessed. I receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness, and I reign in life by one Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. You're blessed. Have an awesome day. Hallelujah.